Hey, are you a business owner, entrepreneur, or professional? If so, we want you to apply to be a featured guest on our show. My name is Adam Torres, and I host the Mission Matters series of podcasts. I've recorded over 3,000 episodes, and we are just getting started. How do you know if you'd be a good guest to be on the show? Well, only one way to find out, and that's to apply, but I'm going to let you in on a little secret. We want guests that have a story to tell, guests with a brand, a product, or a service that can benefit my audience of listeners. If this sounds like you, go to missionmatters.com and click on Be Our Guest to Apply. I'd love to talk to you and get to know more about your story. Again, head on over to missionmatters.com and click on Be Our Guest to Apply. All right, now let's get into the show. Hey, I'd like to welcome you to another episode of Mission Matters. My name is Adam Torres. You can follow me on Instagram at AskAdamTorres. And if you'd like to apply to be a guest on the show, just head on over to our website, missionmatters.com, and click on Be a Guest to Apply. All right, so today is a very special episode. For those that have been following for a while, we do this once a week, and I bring on my co-host, Kamar Zaman, who is a founder over at KissPR. And basically, think about it this way. I get the best info from Kamar for both for my audience and for me as a business owner. So he's my go-to guy who I ask questions to. And we just had so many great conversations through the years that I was like, you know what, we need to do a show together. So Kamar, hey, welcome back. And it's a pleasure, always happy to have you on.
Thank you for having me. I'm super excited today again.
Oh man! So today's topic, you always come with the ones that I'm like, come on, Kamar, tell me more. So today's topic is how to prepare your content for Google, and now Google has some updates and some other things coming up. So I mean, just to get us kicked off, Kamar, maybe give everybody that hasn't heard some of our previous episodes, maybe tell them a little bit more about KissPR so they know your background.
All right. So KissPR is a digital marketing company here based in Dallas, Texas. And I have been in SEO, website design, content marketing for 2 decades. So that does make me feel old, but hey, old is golden. So you're listening from the golden guy. It's fun. So before I talk about the update, since I just say that I've been doing this for 20 years, you know, I started my agency around 2000 and it's been, you know, 20 plus years. And one of the things that we always want is we want to be found. And obviously we cannot be found because we have to use Google. So we have never talked about this. We have talked about content. But if we need to be found, we have to follow the guidelines. Like, you know, when you drive on a highway, you have to follow the police system. So Google is the police. So I wanted to talk about that today.
All right. So I think for everybody listening, everybody know, like when we're thinking about online marketing, when we think about reaching new audiences and what that looks like, and really, I mean, Google, it's just it. Like that, they own this stuff. So maybe just start off with the update and what people should be thinking about.
All right, so before I talk about the update, I want to explain to you what are these updates. So because we are putting content on the search engines, i.e. the Google and the Bing and the Yahoo, one needs to understand that we are relying on their space. This is their space. So Google, even though it's a free search engine, they have to follow the rules. And if we don't, so historically, it used to be very easy for the content creator or the website owner to just build a website, throw some content, and a little bit of sympathy, it would just rank. But those days are gone. And people that are listening that have been in the digital marketing will endorse that you have to think from a lot of aspects. Like when I started my agency, I would build a website, you know, write some content, that was it. It was very one-dimensional. Now we have to build a website. We have to have social media, the Facebook, the Instagram, the LinkedIn. And on top of that, not only are we complying to everybody, we are complying to the big daddy, which is Google. So Google rolls out these updates to their internal databases, as they're called, and we have to comply to them to make sure that we are going to be found. So recently, Google never rolls out an update and gives you, you know, they don't tell you that, hey, we're going to be rolling out an update and you need to do something about it. They never do. But recently, about 2 or 3 months ago, they announced a big update. It's called Core Web Vitals. And we are not talking about that update, but I'll just give you that this is an algorithm update that is happening as we speak. And what Google is looking for to make sure that your websites are ready for that. So that's a pretty complicated update, which we'll talk about in the next episode. But I do want to talk about an update that is rolling out as we speak, and that is called the link update. So every time we, you know, write content, we are getting links, inbound links to our content automatically, or some people are buying them. Some people are just creating link spam. So I want to go over that to talk about that, what is a link, and then when we are putting content on our website, what can we do to not get, you know, punished or penalized by Google. So this update that is coming out is actually a link update, and they are going to punish people that have bad links coming over.
Oh, wow. So just to be clear, so there's good links, bad links. So tell us, I mean, go further into the update. This is interesting.
Right. So let's talk about a link, okay? A link is when you, let's say, get a link to Mission Matters, you listen to a podcast or you are interviewed by, let's say, some famous guy from Forbes, and he interviews you, and then he puts that interview on Forbes.com, and he also mentions that, hey, today I interviewed, you know, Adam Torres of Mission Matters, and he puts a link back to your website. Now, you did not pay for that link. That link is actually organic. However, he linked to you, that's great. So that's what Google is looking for. You know, they are looking for holistic, clean, inbound links to you, and that's great. But now, let's say you contacted somebody and said, you know, you have really good website, and by you giving me a link would really help me, and you manipulated them. You asked them to give you a certain type of link, and you wanted a do-follow link. A do-follow link is a link where the publisher or whoever's giving the link will tell Google that this is a do-follow, so they are trusting you heavily, and they're giving back to you the link. So those do-follow links are frowned upon because you are telling a person to first give you a link in the manner that you want. Number two, you pay them for it, you know, so now you're buying a link. So it's a paid placement rather than organic placement. So those are the things that Google has warned many, many times that don't do it, don't get it. So Google is now making it very, very clear that if you have links like that, you know, we are either going to punish you, or we are just going to ignore them. And whenever Google says they will ignore them, that means that, you know, you're not going to be trusted by Google, hence you're not going to be ranking, you know, in their highway, which is the search engine. So they do follow paid link is a bad thing. You don't want it, you know. Even if somebody gives it to you, tell them, I don't want it. Okay, so that's a paid link. And I'll go further in that. Now, the no-follow link is, which means that, you know, the person or the publisher that is giving you the link is telling Google that, you know, this is based on the merit of me giving to the, because I'm linking to this Adam Torres and I do not know him very well. I am not telling Google to either give any weighted, you know, recommendations. So do your own judgment. So that's a no follow. In other words, I'm not telling Google to give me any weighted reward. And Google is saying to publishers that if you are giving a no-follow link to a person that you don't know yet, then that's what you need to give them, a no-follow. Now, we can go further into that debate and discuss further. But let me see if you understand this, what I've just explained.
Yeah, so there's follows, do follow, and do not follow link. The do follow mm-hmm. link is essentially you. It's possible that Google will frown upon that, and then the do
yes.
not follow one is basically saying, Google, you do your due diligence, and you check whether or not this should rank.
Correct. You put it together perfectly. And there are a lot of SEOs.
I'm taking notes here.
Yeah.
Good. Go ahead.
Yeah. There are a lot of SEOs that they will call us and say, hey, can you get me a link for DoFollow? And I said, well, why do you need DoFollow? And their belief is that if they're getting a DoFollow link from an authoritative website, their site will rank. And my thinking is that, first of all, I will not sell you a DoFollow link. I'm not in the business of selling links. But if you really need to get a link from me, then let me decide what kind of link to give you based on the content that I'm going to publish for you. So if the content is really good and if it's important, then I will link to you, but don't regulate how I'm going to link to you. So that's the way I answer those things. So going further. So once the link is given to you, okay, whether it's a do follow or a no follow, there are certain things that help you rank a website, okay? And I have been able to rank websites even with a no follow link, even without any links. But the important part is that what is that magic? What is the thing that you have in the link that makes it stand out? So you need to understand that. So today's topic that I really wanted to cover was called an anchor text. And I wanted to know from you if you knew what's an anchor text.
So on my end, I'll tell you what I've been told. So, let me start off by saying no, but I'll say what I think I've been told about this. And so what I've been told is, okay, so Mission Matters, we have a lot of podcasting content. So we want to rank one day for the word podcast. So what we do is we put, we hyperlink or we insert links on that word where appropriate when we're on other people's sites, right? So that would be my thought. Is that off? I don't know. Like, you tell me. But that's me taking a shot in the dark.
No. So you have a good understanding that if you want to rank for just the word podcast, then somebody has to link you with the word podcast. So when that link, so if I was reading an article, going back to Forbes again, if I was reading an article in Forbes and there was a paragraph that says, Adam Torres, Mission Matters podcast, and they linked, in other words, the link that I clicked on took me to your website, and that word was called podcast. That's called an anchor text. Okay. Mm. The anchor text will have me click to that to go to you. And so I want to break that type of link. So those are called anchor texts. So the first, so now that we have explained what's an anchor text, I want to explain, and there is a distribution matrix, which I'm not going to go because a lot of people think, well, how much anchor text ratio should I have for a word podcast versus Mission Matters? I usually tell people that don't go into that. Think about the content, right? So if you ever read Wikipedia, and that's the best example, and then you open up Wikipedia, they link you to, let's say if you're reading a Wikipedia page and that talks about what is the podcast, then they will link from the word podcast to another page that actually talks about the podcast, right? So I'm going to explain to you what are the different types of anchor text and what are the good ones and what are the risky ones to do. So the first one is a generic anchor, okay? A generic anchor is the one. So again, going back to the example of Forbes, if somebody was to link from their article and they say, click here to watch the video or click here to listen to the podcast, the word click here is a generic anchor. So that's the first example of anchor. And it should not be controlled. In other words, whoever's giving the link has to decide why they should put the word click here versus the podcast. That's up to them. And the person requesting a link should not manipulate them. You know, so that's the first type of anchor in the keywords. Do you have any questions on that, or is clear?
No, that's great. So, like, and I've seen many people do that, by the way. So, like, when I think about, like, the click here to see, like, I've seen that many times. Go ahead.
Okay. So the next one is a brand anchor. A brand anchor is when they put the name of the person or name of the company. So in your case, Mission Matters Business is the brand. Okay, that's how you'd know it. If I was to type Mission Matters Business, I would see your website on this Google search. So that's the brand anchor. To me, that's my favorite kind of anchor because I want to be known as a brand. Okay. And if you recall, we did a podcast on the Google Knowledge Panel. And if you were to type Adam Torres, and if your Knowledge Panel shows up because your brand is, your name is Adam Torres, Mission Matters is also your brand. So, you know, that's your business and your name is Adam Torres. Now, that is my best recommended anchor. And the reason I say that, because there was a long time, I don't remember the date, but the CEO of Google had said that the future of SEO would be the brands, you know. So I always go for, you know, the KissPR type of link. You know, somebody says, you know, like you've asked me, how can they find me? So just that KissPR. I've never said Dallas SEO, Kamar Zaman, you know, because I always go for the brand. Okay. So Mission Matters Business is your brand anchor. Now, there is another anchor, and that's called your website name. So missionmatters.com. So if somebody wants to link to you, that is your domain anchor, missionmattersdomain.com. So I've seen you, you have linked multiple times internally. Go find something here, and that's missionmatters.com. So that's another good way to link as an anchor. The next one is a full URL. So let's say, if going back to the Forbes example, the person that is giving you the link says, you know, this is my good friend Adam Torres of Mission Matters Business. So he puts a link first to Mission Matters Business, and that would go to your homepage, for example. By the way, we are putting this episode on Forbes.com/Mission Matters Business page that we have created for them. That's a URL anchor. In other words, if somebody wants to learn more to watch this video, they can go to Forbes.com/Mission Matters Business. That's the URL anchor. That's another of my favorite anchor because, you know, some people can easily see that and just go and read it. Now, the SEOs do some kind of manipulation. So what they do is they will create a URL called Forbes.com/Mission Matters. Okay, but then when they're linking, they might say, listen the podcast here. Okay, and they will then link, the anchor text would be podcast. Okay, so when a person goes to the podcast, the person is thinking, well, I'm going to go to iTunes. But they end up going to some other place. So that confuses the user. They may jump off and bounce off, et cetera. There are multiple reasons for that. So be very clear to the user where you're taking them. And when you actually show them that they're going to Forbes.com, Mission Matters, then they are trusting that, okay, I'm going to go someplace and I'm not going to be redirected to go somewhere else. So that's another of my favorite, you know, URL as an anchor.
Oh, that's a great one, and I get exactly what you're saying, too, because when you click on it, you want to know exactly where you're going. So if it's Forbes.com/Mission Matters, then they're like, oh, I'm gonna see this on Forbes.
Exactly, exactly. So it's all about trust. So my linking strategy has always been, if you want to see what Google likes, you have to see the world from Google eyes, okay? So make them believe.
Not to be confused with googly eyes, right? Google eyes.
Exactly. So give the user, you know, cues so they can go exactly to where they're going. The next one is a dangerous anchor. I call this, and all SEO people call it EMA, or it's called the exact match anchor. Exact match anchor is the anchor that you want to rank for. And I'll tell you both things. So you want to ultimately rank for podcasts, right? So let's say you put a link to podcast and it goes there. Now, it's not a bad thing to do, but you are giving away to a competitor, first of all, that anytime you see a link for podcast, that's what I'm trying to rank for. So you are giving away your competitor, your link strategy. That's number one. The next thing is you are telling Google that that's what I want to rank for, so give me some love. And Google says, this guy wants to rank for podcast, and he's been building a lot of links from every place that we have looked at his content, podcast, podcast, podcast. So when Google computes their, in their machine, the ratios, your ratio for all the links that you are getting is 1%, you know, podcast, 99%, everything else. That's, now it's based on the ratio. So if it's 1%, it's not bad. But there are guys that are doing 13, 14, 15, 20, 50% ratios. That's where you are getting into a very risky place. So the next question I asked is, a lot of people ask me, what's a good ratio? My answer is there's no good ratio. You know, just be organic. You know, once a while podcast is fine. Just don't die on it. You know, so there is no such thing as good or bad. It's just that too much of it's definitely bad. And there are ways to come around it. So do you have any questions before I go any further on that?
So how would somebody know? Like, how does somebody know if they should? So, for example, we've been ranking for podcasts and, like, putting our content on that probably for a good, I don't know, 3 months or so, maybe something like that. And when we do a lot of different things. And so how do you know when you should be changing?
Well, that's a great question. So there are tools out there. So if I was to determine, for example, if I go into my tools, I can tell you. So it's kind of like I'm the Oracle, right?
So yeah, I like it. So first you pull out the crystal ball, and then what?
Yeah. So what I do is I put missionmatters.com in my system, and it tells me that your anchor for missionmatters.com is 14%, and your anchor for podcast is 2%. So you are in a safe bet. Okay, but tomorrow, if everything that you started to get was podcasts and your numbers went up to, you know, like over 2 or 3%, you know, 5%, 6%, now you are in a, you know, risk state, you know, because you have to see what Google has to say. Now, sometimes what we do is we do a competitive analysis. So if I was to do a research and just hit the word podcast, okay, to see who comes up for the very first thing, if I type podcast, you know, guess what? Google podcast come up. So you are definitely not going to compete with Google because they come up number one.
Do you think?
Yeah. So they... they are saying that we are the people that would rank. Number two is Apple. Number three is Wikipedia. Number four is Times.com. Okay. So then there is NPR. Then is YouTube. Okay. So the one that is...
so it sounds like we're wasting our time at going after podcasts to me then. Like, that's the way I read it, right? Because there's no way you're going to compete with Google or Apple. Come on.
Well, the only way to compete with Google and Apple are some techniques, which we will talk about in the future episodes. But there are ways to do it. Definitely not the way to put anchor text, podcast, and rank, because
that ain't happening.
Yeah, because that's, I mean, it's in their name. It says podcast.google, okay? One of the problems that you have in your name is that is missionmatters.com. If your domain was missionmatterspodcast.com, then you didn't have to do anything because your brand name was called missionmatters.com. And, you know, the keyword podcast would be in your name. You know, like if your name was Adam Podcast Taurus, okay? then you would thank for it, okay? That's the reason.
Hold on. So what we're saying here is that what we're saying here is I might need a name change. It's worth it.
Well, I that's
middle name Adam Podcast Tour. Sorry, Kumar. I deviate. I'm just go ahead. Continue. I just thought it was funny. Go ahead.
Yeah. But there, it's like so. If you think about your name change,
that's next level branding. Just change your name, okay? Fine.
Yeah. Well, before we started the call, you were talking about scaling, and now this is the fourth stage of scaling. Is change your name.
Oh, man. It's worth it. Fine. Google, you win.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, having the name is definitely beneficial with the keyword.
I'll pick up where you left, or just to recap where we're at, just to make sure, because I went off on a tangent. I had to. It was funny. So we already got the part about follow and do not follow links. We got the part about you went through to all the way up until the anchor text and the thought process of kind of like where our anchor was at, by the way. So podcast, maybe not the best anchor we've been going for, but it's our mission matters. So our brand is at, I think you said 13 or 14%. So that's fine because it's the brand, I believe. And then the other part, the podcast part was only like 1% or so. So it's still reasonable. If it was on the 3% or something else, maybe probably a little bit too much. And then I cut you off. So I think that's where we're at.
Right. So going back to your percentage, you were about 2%. So if you keep organically doing it, you will remain to be, because as you do more mission matters, you know, even though the ratios will change, your brand anchor, which is your missionmatters.com, will change. Okay. So that's not a bad thing. Now, the best thing is that you said you want to be known for Mission Matters podcast, not just Mission Matters. So the next anchor, that's my second favorite, is a brand plus keyword anchor. Okay. Mm. So that is called Mission Matters podcast, where we amplify stories, right? So that's a conversational anchor. Okay. Mission Matters podcast, where we amplify stories. So it's kind of like your vision statement, which has your podcast as a keyword. So if somebody says, you know, I'm going to link back to you, what should I do? It says just link it to our, you know, brand story, which is what, like in my case, we are called KissPR brand story. You know, that's what our, you know, USP is. So they link back to us as KissPR brand story. Your could be Mission Matters podcast, where we amplify stories, you know. So when they link back to you, you're getting a link back to your brand, you're getting a link back, you know, and it's your, basically your vision, or, you know, your mission statement, which is kind of packaged together. So that's very, very safe, and it will get you not in trouble.
This is good. I'm just thinking about the, like, kind of the thought process behind it. And this is good because ideally, and just to make sure I understand correctly, like, for all of these, like, we'd want a mixture of these, right? So like you said, you don't want to all be on one thing. So these are all just different tools that need to be used in different ways. Yeah.
Absolutely. So what happens is this is a common question that I asked. That I get asked is, well, how should we distribute our anchor? You know, this is a common question. So the best way to answer this is, if somebody is linking to you and they are linking to your homepage, they should always link to your brand name, which is Mission Matters Business Podcast, right? Or your missionmatters.com name. So those are the two brand names that you have been carrying, Mission Matters Business Podcast, or Mission Matters, you know, podcast. If they are linking to your money category, because you have categories, right? Mission Matters money category.
Correct.
So if they're linking to you, and let's say you interviewed a person, and I'm looking at it, Making Business Bankable with Monica Coburn. So you publish this content, you give it to her, and she's going to share it. Where is she going to share it to? She's going to put a link back to the money section, because that's where our podcast is. So she should link back to the money section. So to go and listen to my podcast, go to Mission Matters money podcast section, which is what the name of the section would be. So then when somebody searches for best podcast on money, you have a very good chance because you that's your category. That's where your content is. And that's more relevant than to be found for podcasts, you know, because you should be found for the pain that you saw. In this case, the pain is money. And I'm going to also for best podcast. They're not going to send it to Nordstrom. Or if you say, I want to go for, you know, Dillard's, then they will send you to Dillard's. So that's exactly how you should link to your content without overthinking it.
No, this is helpful. This has been a master class on links and backlinks, and I think this is definitely the first time I've ever talked a half an hour about just links. I mean, it's fascinating to me. To all the SEO people out there, they're like, oh, this is what we do all day, all along. I get it, but for somebody that's a novice and just is, and you know, working with other people on them executing these strategies for us, I mean, it's just really helpful.
One more thing on the one anchor, then you can ask me the question. So let's say you publish a content on, I'm in the marketing section of Mission Matters. It says missionmatters.com, category marketing. So we know we are in marketing. Now, you and I did a post on creating a content machine. So let's say you published this, you know, now when I go to the creating content machine page, I'm looking at my content. That's great. So the next thing you want to do is put a link at the end. It says, for related content like this, go and watch related. So what is the related to content machine is that you did another podcast, paid advertising on Google, Microsoft, and Facebook. And that was by Alex Christen. Okay. So when you do a related post, so in other words, in the middle of the content or at the end, says for a related content, you need to also watch this podcast and put the whole link as an anchor text for related : paid advertising on Google, Microsoft, Facebook with Alex. You know, when they click on it, now they go to Alex. Now that is a long tail anchor. In other words, you are using the headline as an anchor. So if somebody was searching for podcast on paid advertising on Google, they are going to find this piece of content directly to your website.
Wow, that's pretty cool. So that's, I mean, I've done that myself, so I never thought about it. Like, how does that article get there when I type this in? And that's many times what it is. It's very close to even the headline that I typed in, right?
Yeah, exactly. And the best resource that you should learn is when you go to entrepreneur.com, read an article. Within their articles, you will always see related articles, related posts. They're interlinking their own content. And that's what Google loves, because when Google crawls on the content machine content and it likes it, then it also needs to know what other good stuff that you have, Mr. Taurus. Oh, you did one on Google, Facebook. I want to crawl that to see. And then once they start seeing the relevance of the content, they start ranking you for multiple, you know, seeds of the content. So entrepreneur.com,
oh, wow. So you're basically interlinking even within your own content, yeah?
That's the best linking. Majority of SEOs are begging, buying, stealing links from people, but the best links are the ones that you create your own.
Oh, wow. That I've never heard. That's so interesting to me, especially because we have so much content. I'm like, oh, my gosh, we got a link. I mean, yeah. We got links on links, right?
Yeah, exactly. So you need to just link, because if the link, what is the purpose of the link? So other person can go and watch that. You know, else they will never find it unless they, you know, really search for it. So by giving them, it's like Amazon. When you buy something, they'll say, hey, these people also bought, you know, this, because they're interlinking for related content so you can buy more. In your case, you're not selling anything. Say, by the way, you should also watch this.
Yeah, it's also just like at the end of a YouTube video, right? Like at the end of a YouTube
exactly.
video. When they,
exactly.
When they
Why do, does YouTube do that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, why does
and
YouTube?
And ideally, over time, if somebody clicks on those other ones, then like they're gonna know, like Google's gonna know, and they're gonna just rank it as that much more valuable as of a resource. And it's also gonna keep people on your website longer, right?
Exactly. All big newspapers.
So all of those things add up.
Yeah.
Man, this is good. Man, you came with it. You came with it today, Kumar. You were not joking around. I get you talking about links, and you go on fire.
Yeah. Well.
Oh man, well this is great. This has been great. So a final as we kind of wrap this up, Kumar. So
sure.
Going
yeah.
into, and I know you gave a lot of content and context here, and for everybody listening, you might want to go, if you weren't taking notes on this one, you might want to go back and start taking notes on this, because Kumar did provide quite a bit. He provided his own masterclass in a half an hour or so, or 40 minutes or so, however long we've been on this. But that being said, so getting back to the update, like what should business owners, obviously, like number one, I hope they call you and they work with KissPR. Like that'd be the goal, in my opinion. If you're, and I'll give you the opportunity to leave your contact info so that people can follow up. But again, going into these updates for Google, you gave a whole list of different things that are happening. Like, what should business owners be thinking about like today? Like, because sometimes they don't want to get started with something. They're like, oh, this is a whole new strategy or thing. But like, what's that low hanging fruit that they should be thinking about like today?
My advice to all business owners, and especially I went through this process myself, that hire a consultant to just do an audit. Don't hire them to do the work and do the audit, okay? Because that's, you came from a finance background. The person that does the audit and the person that does the work should be separate. So always create independence. So hire a person that should do the audit, and then tell them what should I do, and tell, you know, he should recommend you to go and find or recommend you somebody that he thinks would be appropriate. But never hire the same person, because the person that is hiding the stuff will do a bad audit. And even if it's a good auditor, you know, his perception of doing things will be skewed. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that if Google is doing this today, don't panic. Because when you panic, you know, obviously Google is, you know, if you haven't done it right, then Google will shake you up. But that doesn't mean that things cannot be fixed. And what people do is right away they go and hire somebody. There are a lot of people that are selling these services, and I don't. I just consult people, and then I guide them what to do next. I would not definitely not fix their issues. So I just do as an audit, like a doctor would, you know, and I give you a prescription for it. So then take, you know, and understand what the guy is telling you, and then slowly make changes to your system. If you have been slapped by Google, it will take time to recover. But if you have not been slapped by Google, then set up some ways, and there are ways we recommend people to do. So definitely look into that. But don't panic, because when you start panicking, you will start making changes on a day-to-day basis, and you will never know what's going on. So always wait for the algorithm to finish. Once it's done, and if you know you are on the first page and you bounced off to second page, something happened, wait for that 1 week to pass and then start fixing things. If you're in the ninth position and you went on the first page, obviously you did something good. You know, you had something good, and Google rewarded you because the bad ones just dropped off. So that's my insight. And obviously, if they need to give me a call, find me, kisspr.com is where they need to go.
Fantastic. And again, that's kisspr.com. And of course, we'll have that, you know, hyperlinked in the show notes and all that good stuff. So don't worry about that. Waiting for the viewers. And man, this has just been a great show. I got tons of notes here, tons of things to go back and to review. And I hope all the listeners took great notes too. And so that being said, one more time, that website, kisspr.com. And Kumar, as always, pleasure having you on the show. And to the audience, as always, thank you for tuning in. If you're a first-time listener, don't forget, hit that subscribe button. We definitely want you to come back and to be a return listener and visitor. We have many more mission-based entrepreneurs and businesses coming up, and we don't want you to miss anything. And Kumar, again, as always, pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you so much, and hope everything goes well with the Google search results coming up next week.